love you more than anything. But guess what? With all my love, with all your love, with all the love that everyone on the face of this earth has for the Lord, if we put it all together, we can't go past his anger and his love compared to his love for us. The song said, they hung him high. They stretched him wide. He bowed his head. For me, he died. Now that's love. Now think about all those times where you could care less about Jesus. And he knew, way back 2,000 years ago, he knew about all of us who could care less about him. And he died. He said, Father, forgive them. But they know not what they do. Do you love him today? Do you really, really love him today? If you really love him, why don't you stand to your feet and give him a clap of praise? And tell him, Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. Lord, I bless your name. Lord, I magnify your holy name. Worthy. Now you can be praised. You said if you be lifted up, you will grow all in unto you. Lord, we praise you. We adore you. We magnify your holy. We would like to say happy Mother's Day to all of you out there. We thank God for the mothers, because men, we just couldn't do it. Couldn't do it. Could not love the way a mother loves. A mother will jump in front of a Mack truck. Save a child. Not saying that daddy wouldn't do it, but for mama, ain't even gonna think twice about doing whatever needs to be done for a child. And we would like to say happy Mother's Day to each and every one of you. And I would like to acknowledge three very special mothers in my life. And the first mother is my dearest beloved wife, Joyce McNair. Happy Mother's Day, baby. Very quick behind me. Said that I don't see how you can put up with him. But she just like that energizer bunny. I mess up. She keeps right on loving. Keep right on loving. Keep right on loving, and I thank God for her. And the second mother that's dear to my heart is Andrea Oxendine McNair. She is one of a kind, and we fight like cats and dogs. She's the only one that can put me in my place instantly without just one word, boom, I bow down. And I thank God for her as to how she has loved my son, loved my grandchildren, and just raised them. And if I had 100 daughter-in-laws, she would still be my favorite. I thank God for her. And last but not least, my little baby. The speaker for today, I was her father. She was my daughter until 2016. And in 2016, she became my mother. She became my mother. And I say that because throughout all pain that I was going through while I was in the hospital, she would come in my room and have this great big smile and laughing and joking, and she would always lift me up. And I didn't know that when she left me laughing and joking, she went to her car and just sat in the car and cried because of the condition that I was in. And not only did that she had to take care of me as a mother. She had to take care of George as a mother, because I was in Norfolk General Hospital, and she, George, was in Lake Taylor, rehabbing from knee surgery. And not only was Trell working full time, she was going to grad school full time. Not only that, my granddaughter James was her first year going to college at Norfolk State. And so Trell had to take care of all of us all at the same time. And that's a true mother. That's a true mother. And we thank God for her and how she, and not only did she take care of all of us, she graduated from honor.
Yes.
And I thank God for Trell, Dion, McNair, Jones. And after another selection from this great choir, let's give this choir. They sound good.
Yeah.
Give our musicians a round of applause. Thank you. God is truly, truly blessing us. And after a selection from them, and we're going to be favored with a praise dance from Miss Coke. Thank you.
Let me go. How let go, let it be. Cause oh Lord, Lord, only is what's best for me. Oh,
talking about relentless love, and the scripture is coming from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 18 through 19. So it says, and I pray that you and all God's holy people will have the power to understand the greatness of Christ's love, how wide and how long and how high and how deep that love is. Christ's love is greater than anyone can ever know, but I pray that you will be able to know that love, then you can be filled with the fullness of God.
Amen.
That's right. Lord, we come to you today saying thank you. We thank you for allowing us to just be here on this Sunday, on this Mother's Day, to celebrate all of the wonderful mothers out there. Lord, we just thank you for just blessing us to get to the month of May in itself, Lord.
Amen.
We ask that you would just please forgive us of all of our sins, forgive us of any doubt, any fear that we have for not trusting you, Lord. We just ask that as we go throughout this day and throughout this message, Lord, that you would, one, use me to give your word and let someone be touched by what I say. And I ask that you would please remove the fear from me and just speak through me, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So I'm going to take you guys on a journey of how God prepared me for today and for this message. So sometime in April, maybe the middle of April, I had just gone back to work. I had been out of work for 6 weeks. I want to say it was like my first day back to work. And my dad came in where I was working at, and he said, hey, you want to speak for Mother's Day? Nope. And he was, come on, you look. Nah, I'm good, I don't want to do it. So then I was like, all right, I'll let you know. Now normally, he asked me every year, and I say no. And normally I'll avoid him until he finds somebody else to do it. And then I'm like, all right, we good, so I don't have to do it. But this time, I don't know if God was like, okay now. You know, so I'm like, shoot. So I text him back maybe like 5 minutes later, and I was like, I'll do it. So then I sat there, I'm supposed to be working, sat there, and I said, okay, God, so what am I supposed to talk about? I didn't say nothing. I ain't getting nothing. Like, I'm like, okay. There was some, because I immediately got nervous. This thing, this was like maybe like 3 or 4 weeks ago. I just got nervous, like, oh God, what am I gonna talk about? And he didn't say anything. I didn't get anything. So I just had my music playing in the background. And one of my favorite songs came on that I listened to, like, once it comes on, I keep putting it on repeat. And it's called In Spite of Me by Tasha Cobb. And it came on, and I was listening to it. And it's, the song says, beyond my mistakes, I'm found in your grace. And this one thing will never change. You still love me in spite of me. You still chose me. How can it be? Every scar, every flaw, you see it all. Then it goes on to say, can I get a witness? You didn't give me what I deserve. Love so relentless. So I was like, oh, okay, God, I see what you did. Then you want me to talk about relentless love. Okay. So I said, all right, cool. So I'm going to talk about how mother's love is relentless. That's easy. So we go on a journey. So I said, okay, so first I'm going to talk about my biological mother, Rosetta McNair. She passed away when I was 9. But what I do know is her love for me and my brother was like, I call it like a knuck if you buck type of love, because if you mess with me or my brother or any kid that she loved, she's coming for you. So that's just what I remember of her. And then I was blessed when I was 10 to have First Lady. And y'all know First Lady, she's so sweet, and she's a prayer warrior and everything. But growing up, sis would get picked. She was that mom that would pick the phone up at 9:31. Trell, do you know what time it is? Yes. Well, say goodnight. That means you better get off the phone because you're supposed to be up home at 9:30. Or standing outside in front of your porch with your friends, like it's getting dark. She flipping the lights. Like, you right in front of the house. She don't care. Get in the house. So she was that type of mother, but she taught us responsibility. She taught us, you know, how to present yourself. She taught us so many things. So the two of them combined molded me into the mother that I am. So, you know, for for 13 years, it was just me and Jalen. Anybody who knows me, knows Jalen, who was there from the beginning, knows I don't play about that one. I do not play. You mess with her, you got a problem with me. I don't play. Then I was blessed with three more girls. All girls. Three more girls. And I love them just as much, you know, as I love Jalen. And them too, they know that we fuss and fight, but they know at the end of the day, I'm going to always have their back. And that's that relentless love, you know, that I felt like God wanted me to talk about. So I'm like, all right, cool. That's going to be easy. Talk about Mother's Day, boom. It'd be time to go. We go eat dinner. It'd be like 10 minutes. I'm good. So I said, all right, guys, so I'm done. This is about 3 weeks ago. All right, I'm done. I'm going to talk about mothers, read scripture, I'm going to pray. I'm done. God was kind of like, yeah, okay. That was cute and everything, but that ain't it. So I'm like, okay. Oh, okay, so I get it. So you want me to talk about, you know, how your love is relentless and, you know, give them a personal story about what you've done for me. So I'm like, okay, that's going to be easy. So a couple of years ago, I was headed to work, driving down Princess Anne Road in Norfolk. And it was about 6:30 in the morning, I was going over the railroad track. And I'm on the railroad track, and it's like, as soon as I get on the track, the gates started coming down, and all I could hear is horns blowing. I heard a train's horn, I heard cars horns, and I'm on the track, and the train was like literally like where I was. And all I could think was, Lord, I'm about to die. I'm going to die. This train is going to hit me because there was no way for me to get off of that track. And then all of a sudden, I was not on the track anymore. I don't know how I got off the track. It was like God picked the car up, turned it around, got me off the track. And I'm like, okay, my heart's racing. And I look over to a car that was waiting on the other side of the track. And this man, he just looked at me and he just put his head down like, oh my God, because I feel like he thought too that, you know, I'm going to get hit. This girl's going to die. Or whatever, but like I said, there was nothing but God that got me off of that track, and that showed me, you know, okay, God, you really do love me. That's that relentless love. And, you know, being in church your whole life, you hear stories, you hear testimonies about how, you know, God has done all these miraculous things, and you believe it, but until God actually does it for you, it's like, oh my goodness, that's what people talk about all, you know, all the time in church. So I said, okay, God, that was it right there. That's what you want me to talk about. We good. Like, okay, the two things, you'll get 12 minutes, and we're done. So God said, oh, okay. Yeah, that was nice. That was a nice story, too, but that ain't it. Shoot, what else you want me to talk about? So I didn't get anything. He goes, hey, you'll know when you know. You'll know when you know. So then I'm nervous. I'm like, well, what am I going to know? What am I going to know? You know? So, and then, you know, just thinking about the song Candace just danced to, I wrote words down because Candace knows I mess up some words in a minute. But the song starts out and it says, I wish I could tell you just what I want, and you give it to me just like that. But the truth of the matter, what I want just might hurt me, and you won't let me go out like that. You know my end before my beginning. Calculated blessings down to the penny. Mm-hmm. So I'm still, you know, she told me she was gonna dance to this song about, I want to say maybe a week ago or so, and I was listening to it, heard this song a million times, and the song is a million, I've heard it a million times, but that song hits different, again, when you know what you know. You know, when God blesses you and God does these things for you, when you hear those songs, those lyrics again, you're like, oh my God, thank you, Lord. Or even my song that I love, In Spite of You, listen to the song, God chose me. How could it be? Why did he choose me? So I'm still waiting. I was waiting. I was like, okay, I still don't know what else you want me to talk about on Mother's Day. He said, okay, you'll know when you know. So now, but I do know now. So a couple of years ago, again, I don't remember. You remember when we had your birthday thing at the beach? How many years ago was that? 19 or 18? Was that 2018 or 2019?
When I turned 40, so that was 2 years ago.
So 2019. So 2019, we were going down to the beach, Max Bay, at Antoine. So Antoine's fam was all playing at the beach, and the whole family was going down there for his birthday. Me and my husband, Ryan, y'all boy, Miss Ruby, Sheila, y'all boy, okay? That's y'all food. First lady. So we got into the biggest argument that we had ever been in our lives. Like, it was bad. Like, we fussed from the town we pulled out of the driveway to the town we got to the beach. We did not talk to each other the whole time at the beach. I got there, went to talk to my cousins. He was somewhere. Left from the beach, got back in the car, we picked up right where we left off. And I mean, we went at it. And it was one of those ones, you made me sick. Well, I can't stand you. I'm not happy. So it was hard, y'all. And it was like one of those arguments where we both were like, this is it. We done this. We tried, it didn't work. So got in the house, we still fussing. We went back outside, we still fussing. And it went on for hours. I have no idea how it started. I cannot remember to this day how it started. But whatever it started, it was him. And it was just bad. So he went in Brianna's room, and then I went in our room. So I'm like, all right. So I said, let me say my prayers. And I was like, Lord, you know, forgive me for this divorce that I'm about to do. This is not working. I was like, well, I know you don't want me in a situation like this. You don't want this for me. So I said, forgive me, because this is what is about to happen. So I laid down. Next thing you know, God said, go in the room. Go pray for your husband. Go pray for your marriage. I said, oh, no, that's not about to happen. So, and I still, and I'm 45 years old, I still get nervous when my parents say, oh, we need to talk. I'm like, oh, well, what I do? Like, I'm 45 years old. So we go, it was a Sunday, I never forget it. And we went in the living room and he said, now mind you, we had never had a conversation with him about the fact that we were thinking about moving. Because at the time we had no idea how it was going to happen anyway. So he said, I think you guys need to have your own space. And this, that, and the third, and he's giving these ideas. And I'm sitting there like, wow. Excuse me, like, how did he know that? Like, so that kind of made it easier for me because I'm like, okay, now I don't have to say it to them because he said it to me. So I'm like, all right, cool. So still time goes on. We, you know, still don't know how we're going to move. So started getting things in order. So in March of this year, we finally went to, in December of last year, we finally sold the house. And my parents bought the house. I'm like, okay, I'm happy. I know where they're going to be. They're going to be good. And this, that, and the third. So March comes, we go see this lender just to see, you know, because we're thinking we're going to go in there and he's going to say, all right, if you need to do this, you need to do this, come back in a few months, come back in a year. We didn't know. So we go talk to the man, and I swear we were in there maybe 20 minutes, 25, 30 minutes, tops, no more than 30 minutes. Man said, oh, y'all are good. Y'all approved for this amount. And first of all, when he said the amount, me and Ron got a little chill, like, is he looking at the right thing? Like, what is he looking at? Like, so he was like, oh, y'all are great. Y'all, you know, I feel like y'all are a great couple, this and her. And we were immediately in this man's office. We're praising God. Both of us are like, oh my God, thank you, thank you, thank you. He said, yeah, y'all approved. I'll go ahead and write your approval letter, this and third. So, wow. You know, we so happy, thank you, Jesus. And we're like, you know, we're going to keep it a secret because we want to surprise everybody when the time comes to leave the house. So that was a Saturday. That next day, the very next day, we went with the girls to look at our house. Didn't see anything. Then that Monday, we went with the girls to the end looking at houses, and we saw this one house that we really love. And we're like, okay, yeah, we'll put a bid in on that house. We didn't get it. They didn't accept our offer or whatever, but we weren't that bummed out about it. Okay, we just started, so it's no big deal. So we went with this realtor, I don't know how many times, we looked at houses, can't find anything. So then on my birthday, April 22nd, we went and looked at two houses. And we went to the first house, and was like, oh, we're like that. But we had Rihanna with us at the time. We call her our little mini realtor because she looks for houses for us and everything. She sends us like $250,000 houses and all this stuff. So we went to this other house and we all completely fell in love with this house. I mean, it was everything. The house was everything that I wanted in the house. And it was just beautiful, beautiful home. And matter of fact, my brother had FaceTimed me when we were leaving out the house to tell me happy birthday. So I'm telling him, yeah, we're out looking at the house and turned the phone, showed him the house and everything. He's like, oh, wow, that's beautiful. This, that, and third. So we got home and the realtor was like, so what y'all want to do? We're like, yeah, we want to go to get there for. So he put the offer in, and before we signed the paperwork for the contract, me and Ron was like, okay, we're going to pray about it. So he prayed about it. He was like, okay, Lord, you know, your will. This is your will for us. This is what it's going to be. So we signed it, sent it on off. The next day, I went on the site, and the house said contention. So in my mind, that was for us. That meant it was for us. It was actually yes. So I texted the realtor, and I said, you know, he asked me, so guys, I think we need to, you know, still look at some houses just in case this one doesn't work out. Well, they trying to trick me. They know that they accepted our offer and they trying to trick me. So I was thinking, so I texted him and I said, well, okay, that's fine. But you know, I see the house says contingent, and my realtor didn't even know yet that it said that because the other realtor, the Selkie realtor, hadn't reached out to him about our offer or anything. So he was like, well, let me check on it. And he had never gotten back with us that night or anything. And so I'm thinking, oh yeah, he called Ronnie and told Ronnie that we got the house. So they're gonna surprise me for my birthday and tell me that we got the house. Cool. So I'm like waiting. So this is Friday. So that Friday night, Ronnie had put out or whatever, and he came back. Okay, he hadn't surprised me yet. So I said, okay, no problem. Because Saturday is coming. So Saturday I had dinner with my girlfriends for my birthday. So I've got it all planned out in my head, y'all. I say, okay, Ronnie gonna come. come to the restaurant, probably and they gonna say, happy birthday. Y'all, you got a house. So we went to dinner, and I'm like, so they never came to dinner. So we left dinner, and I was with my best friend, and she told me she had to go to Burlington to meet her friend or something. So we sitting out in the parking lot, and Burlington, Ronnie pulls up. I said, oh, okay, so this is it. Okay, he coming to get me, to take me to the house, tell me where we at. So we get in the car, and he was like, I want you to go for a ride with me. And I know if you had went in the house already, if you had already got to the house, you wouldn't want to go. So I'm like, okay, I swear y'all, in my head, I said, oh, we're going to the house, we're going to the house. He don't put a sign up that said it's yours, some balloons, something. Because I know, we pray about this house, we got this house. So we didn't go to the house. And I'm like, okay, what is he waiting for? And actually, we went and we stayed at a hotel that night, had it decorated all nice and pretty and stuff. He's gonna tell me later. You know, it's coming. I know I got to do my birthday. We prayed about it. We got this house. Sunday morning, we woke up. We still didn't tell me. So I said, so we really didn't get that house? And he was gonna be like, no, we didn't get it. I was like, I'm not gonna surprise for you. That's it. You know? So I'm like, Dex, I was really, really bummed. I mean, my feelings were hurt because I knew we got this house. And, then Monday, no, that was Sunday. So our realtor was going out of town for Monday, California. And he texted us and said, you know, hey, I'm going out of town for the rest of the week, but I'm going to have another realtor, you know, working with you guys just in case you see something. I don't want you to decide on anything. So I was like, look, I don't want to look at no houses until like next week because I'm still bummed about that, the last one. So that Friday, I went over my cousin's house, Pam's house, and I'm telling her, I said, Pam, it was so pretty, and then that third, the kitchen was just this, and she just looked at me like, sure, you gotta trust the process. And she did something here, and I know she said that to me all day. She said that all the time, you gotta trust the process, you gotta trust the process. And we, you know, she said it, and you know she's right, but you're just like, that ain't what I want you to tell me right now. I want you to feel what I feel right now. I want you to feel about this kitchen that we didn't get. She just looked and she just called. She's like, my dad. It's going to be all right. Just trust the process. Just trust the process. All right, bye. I don't want to talk to you about no more. That one. I don't want to. So that Monday, I don't think we went to look at the house. Tuesday came and we went with the fill-in realtor and saw two of the worst houses that we had ever seen. Now, mind you, in my head, I'm still thinking about this last house that we didn't get, so nothing is going to compare to this house. So those two houses were horrible. I mean, horrible. It was so bad when we got home. Ronnie told me that I owed him gas money. So it may be a good house, you know, but they're not going to go see it. So we did end up finding some pictures, but they weren't on that site. So I said, well, we can go see it. I said, it may be interesting. So we went, and I told him, I'm going to drive today because I feel like if I drive, then one of the houses is going to be good, and I don't have to pay you on gas money. So we went to the first house, and I'm like, I don't know about this. And then we went to the house, it was 6:30 in the evening, went to the house that didn't have the pictures. And when we walked up to the house, when we got to the neighborhood, we were like, oh wow, this is a nice neighborhood, it's beautiful. Then we walked up to the house, like, oh wow, it has a nice covered porch in the front, it's a nice house. And then we finally got in, and every room that I went in, I was like, ooh, ooh. And Ryan was like, okay, she's saying a lot of oohs on this house, right? So we went through it, loved the house, beautiful, it's a beautiful home. And the realtor was like, so, you know, y'all want to put a unit in for it? Like, yeah. So she said, well, I'm calling Eddie, who is our actual realtor. So I'm calling him and let him know he's still going to do everything, you know, from California. So, okay, cool. So, mind you, there were no pictures of the time. Said, the site said it had 43 pictures. Not one picture ever posted on the house. The house was on the market for 5 days. And anybody who knows about the housing market right now, a house being on the market for 5 days, something got to be wrong with it. Because houses are going, like, they be on the market for like 2 hours, and they have contracts just like that. So we trying to figure out, why is this house been on the market for 5 days? And one, why have we never seen it? Because we were like on it, like every day, all day long. We're looking. My realtor's looking. Nobody has seen it. So realtor put it, he called and said, okay, guys, we're going to go ahead and put the bid in. Blah, blah, blah. So, okay. Very next day, our realtor called us, and he was like, it was that night, he called us and said, hey guys, they accepted your offer, you know, y'all got the house, or whatever. So we were like, we looked at each other like, wait a minute, what? Now let me tell y'all, right now when you're buying a house, it's like a bidding war. Like, you have to keep going above and beyond the asking price. People are saying, I don't want this, you don't have to do this, this, that, the third. Don't y'all know that God set this house aside just for us? Yes. Not one person, that went to see this house but us. Nobody bid on that house but us, so we didn't have to go through that whole bidding war thing. And it was just like, we just both was like, oh my God, that's not it. We still not done. So we're like, oh my God, thank you, Jesus, thank you, Lord, oh my goodness. So it was like, it was the craziest thing to us, because we're trying to still figure out, what's wrong with this house? Why is this? Why has it been 5 days? Why has no one bid on the house? Why did no one go see it? And because to us, the house was just beautiful. So our realtor was like, okay, we'll go ahead and set up the inspection for next week when I get back. So Wednesday, we went to the house for the inspection. And when we pulled up, the inspector was already there, and he was, you know, taking all these pictures and everything. So Ronnie said, oh Lord, when they take pictures, that means it's bad. It's bad when they take pictures. So Wednesday, so we were waiting for our realtor to come so we can get in the house. And y'all, the inspector said, this is one of the best kept houses he has ever seen in his life. And that man said, he looked under the house, he could go and in and see all the way through. And that's how clean it was under the house. There's no issues with the house. There's no nothing. He said it may be like two things that you might want to fix maybe later down the line, but it's nothing. I mean, and the fact that when we put the bid in, our realtor was like, well, I think we need to do an information only thing just to stay, you know, marketable or whatever, stay in the game. So say information only inspection, which means that they're not going to fix anything. But that inspector said, there's nothing to fix on this house. Y'all, there's nothing. I mean, absolutely nothing. We're waiting like, okay, what's wrong with this? I mean, he said not one thing. He said, this house has been kept so clean. I've never seen a roof like this. I've never seen everything. The inspector himself was in shock. Like, so we're like, this was nothing but God. Yes. This was God showing us his relentless love for him. You know, for us, you know, God said, you know, y'all, like, we sit up here worried about, you know, how we gonna find a house, how we gonna afford a house, how we gonna do this, how we gonna do this. 5 days, y'all, this house was on the market. 5 days, nobody had gone to see it. The pictures never posted. Mm-hmm. There are no pictures. Even the little pictures that we saw don't do the house any justice at all. Like, I don't even want to show anybody the pictures because it doesn't do the house any justice. And it was like, God, thank you. Like, I mean, that was just for us. He set that aside for us, and God said, that is that relentless love that I have for y'all. It's not because we deserve it. You know, we don't deserve it because we mess up every day, probably gonna mess up as soon as we leave out of here. But God said, I still love you. I have, amen. You know, that's relentless love that I have for you guys. And I mean, the only thing that we did consistently was trust God. We tied consistently, and that's it. I mean, but we sure could not have made this happen. Our realtor couldn't have made this happen. No one could have made this happen for us. But God, and that's that relentless love that God wanted me to talk about today.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Relentless love. And that's the kind of love.
That's the kind of love that God has for us. He had that house set aside all the time and revealed the home just in time.
Amen.
We serve an on-time God.
Yeah,
yeah. Hallelujah. The song says he's a long-time God.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is.
Yes,
he is. Yes, he is. Yes. Yes, he is. Hallelujah. Perhaps there's someone out there today that don't know Jesus. In pardon of your sins. We serve a God that we don't have to chase after him. He's chasing after us.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He sent his son while we were yet in our sins. We didn't even care.
Amen.
Hallelujah. But he sent his son to die so that we might live. That's relentless.
Amen.
He came from 40 and two generations. I'm not going to preach. I feel like it though. He came from 40 and two generations. He came from his heavenly home. Born of a virgin. And lived a life. Showed us how to live. And not only that, he'll do what he did for Trell and Ronnie. Just try me. He said, try me, says the Lord. See, don't I pour you out a blessing that you won't have room enough to receive. If I had 1,000 tongues, I would be able to express how good God is.
Yeah.
He's the Alpha and the Omega.
Yeah.
He's beginning and the end. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. If you don't know that, you ought to try today. Bible says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, he's not a respecter of persons, believeth in him, should not perish. You won't perish, but you'll have everlasting life. Like she just said, in spite of us, he's relentless. Hallelujah. He'll show up even when we mess up. That's the kind of God we serve. Hallelujah. Will there be one this morning that will call on his name and say, I need you every hour. I need you. I'm calling on you. Hallelujah. He said, if you confess your faults, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. He's already done it. All you got to do is accept it.